September 8th, and this is your Coffee Break on the HAN Network. I'm Kate Czaplinski with Frank Granito, and we have the latest local news for you today, including a teen being forced off the road in Easton due to a road rage incident, a boat rescue in Darien, and some roadside assistance for a red-tailed hawk. John Kovach also joins me later, and we take a look at the front pages of our HAN newspapers this week. Frank Granito will have a look at the forecast and your Nutmeg Sports update, and Donald Ang will join us to take a look back on this day in history. But first, the Darien Police Marine Division and the Narroton Fireboat helped at the scene of a boat crash on September 3rd. According to police, a group of four boaters hit a patch of rocks near Hay Island, leaving their boat stuck and completely out of the water. Two of the four passengers had been ejected, but were aided by a Long Neck Point resident in a kayak. The Narroton Fireboat transported the other two marooned boaters back to land. That boat eventually capsized and was towed away by a private company. Three of the four passengers, who were all Darien residents, were transported to the hospital with some minor cuts and bruises. And a Fairfield man has been charged with forcing a teenage driver into a tree in a road rage incident in Easton. Hearst, Connecticut media reports that 31-year-old Ishmael Campos of Garden Drive was charged Tuesday with second-degree reckless endangerment and evading responsibility. Campos, who told police he is an arborist, was released on a promise to appear in court. Back on August 8th, police say that a 17-year-old youth was driving north on Sport Hill Road when he came upon a tractor-trailer truck that was stopped in the northbound lane unloading freight. Police said the youth was waiting to be waved around the truck when the driver of the car behind him, later identified as Campos, began honking his horn and making aggressive motions at the young person. When the youth was finally able to go around the stopped truck, police said Campos drove up behind the youth, forcing the car off the road into a tree. Campos then drove off without stopping. The impact of the crash shattered the car's windows and deployed the airbag, but police say the youth was not injured. And in Bridgeport, a male victim was shot in the back Wednesday night while riding a bicycle on Maple Street near the intersection with Kosuth Street, according to the Connecticut Post. Police said the victim was taken to a hospital with non-life-threatening injuries, and officers were looking for a red car that was connected with that incident, which happened around 9:30 at night. It was not clear whether the assailant fired from the car or exited the vehicle before shooting. Bridgeport Police Captain Brian Fitzgerald said the victim, who police did not identify, told him that he did not see the shooter. Fitzgerald said police believe that one gun was used in that attack. And in other news, the Milford Police Department is investigating a serious motorcycle accident that occurred on Labor Day at about 11:50 in the morning in the area of Woodruff Road and Burnt Plains Road and has left a young man in critical condition. An investigation revealed that a motorcycle was traveling northbound on Woodruff Road near Burnt Plains Road. The operator, 19-year-old Alexander Mazzoni of Milford, lost control as he was approaching the intersection of Burnt Plains Road, causing the motorcycle to fall and throwing him off the motorcycle and into a vehicle that was stopped at a stop sign. Mazzoni was transported to a local hospital for his injuries. Police said he is in critical but stable condition. And that incident is still under investigation, and police are asking anyone with information to contact them at 203-878-5244. Police in Willimantic arrested a man they say burglarized a home, then fled from police, leading to an officer-involved shooting at the vehicle. On Tuesday at about 2 in the afternoon, officers from the Willimantic Police Department responded to 44 Ashland Street in Willimantic for a reported burglary. Upon arrival, officers observed a black male suspect identified as Ordo Fletcher fleeing the area in a vehicle. Police attempted to stop Fletcher, however, he refused to stop and engaged police in pursuit. During the course of that pursuit, Fletcher's vehicle intentionally rammed police cruisers and several parked cars. A Willimantic police officer fired at least one round from their duty weapon at Fletcher in his vehicle, but no injuries were reported. Fletcher then fled from the vehicle on foot. State troopers from Colchester responded to assist, and state police canine teams also helped in the search. Fletcher was later located and taken into custody, where he was held on a bond pending his court date. And as we discussed yesterday on CT Pulse, Weston First Selectman Nina Daniel is taking a medical leave of absence from her position as Weston's First Selectman. In an announcement sent to town hall workers yesterday morning, Selectman Dennis Tracy said the leave will run for the next several weeks, and Daniel expects to be back at work by October 3rd. He did not elaborate on the reason for the leave. Daniel's medical leave follows an extended two-week vacation, which she announced she was taking last Tuesday following a special selectman's meeting. Tracy has been acting as interim first selectman since last Wednesday and said he plans to continue to do so during Daniel's medical leave. He said that town business will continue as normal. The Weston Board of Selectmen are holding a special meeting tonight at 7:45 in the commission room at Weston Town Hall. And the first item on the agenda is a discussion regarding an employee of a public office. The agenda says this item is expected to be discussed in executive session. And while it does not say that the public officer or employee in question is Nina Daniel, last week there was a similar agenda item for the same reason. But we are going to switch gears now and throw it over to Frank Granito for a look at the forecast. Frank.
Thank you, Kate. Very warm today with plenty of humidity, as we will see temperatures in the mid to high 80s. Mostly sunny throughout the day with some scattered cloud cover moving in later on. Temperatures will drop down to the low 70s overnight, and there is a chance for passing showers and thunderstorms before Friday morning. Temperatures up into the low 90s on Friday, but with the humidity, that number will feel a lot closer to 100 degrees outside. Partly cloudy during the day, but we can expect clear skies when the evening rolls around and football kicks off on what should be a perfect night here throughout Fairfield County. Clear skies overnight and temperatures dipping down to a low of 71 degrees. Saturday will be another beautiful day outside, less humid, a little more cloud cover, and it will be mostly sunny with temperatures in the low to mid 80s during the day. Overcast and humid Saturday night with some passing showers heading into Sunday morning, but things should clear up in the afternoon as we get ready for the start of NFL football, Kate.
All right, very exciting, Frank. Thank you so much. We're going to step out for a break. When we come back, we have a lot more news to talk about, including a car stolen in Darien, found in Stamford. That and a lot more coming up, as well as a look back on this day in history and a Nutmeg Sports update after this. Have a sports injury or a slip and fall that needs immediate care? Coastal Ortho Express Urgent Care gives you direct access to an orthopedic specialist fast, without an appointment. Biking, golf, tennis, soccer, whatever the sports injury is, sprain or fracture, Coastal Ortho Express can help. Coastal Ortho Express Urgent Care, open Monday through Saturday, now in two locations. The iPark building at 761 Main Avenue in Norwalk and 36 Old Kings Highway South in Darien. Or go to CoastalOrthoExpress.com, like them on Facebook.
Hi, this is Leo Carl from Carl Chevrolet in New Canaan. And you've heard me talk about the Chevy Volt for years. The new model gets 53 miles on EV charge daily, plus 420 mile full range. But don't take my word for it. You need to come in and test drive the Volt yourself. Visit us at 261 Elm Street in New Canaan or online at CarlDirect.com.
Back to school means back to busy, and Stewart's Market can save you precious time by stocking all of your favorite essentials under one roof. For a healthy start to school, we have all the ingredients. Walter Stewart's, your family-owned fresh local market, 229 Elm Street and at stewartsmarket.com.
At the Ridgefield Suzuki School, we believe that every child can. Using the internationally recognized Suzuki method, children learn to play their instrument in an environment of encouragement, parental support, and community. The Suzuki approach seeks to develop the whole child to help unfold his or her natural potential to learn. Private lessons and group classes are offered on violin, viola, cello, and piano for children ages 4 and up, and young children can enroll in the school's early childhood classes before beginning an instrument. The Ridgefield Suzuki School, nurturing a love of music in all children. Call us at 203-403-2667 or visit RidgefieldSuzukiSchool.com.
At Greenwood Physical Therapy of Bethel, individualized care, knowledgeable staff, and state-of-the-art equipment provide the best of orthopedic and sports medicine services. Our experienced therapists at Greenwood provide the highest level of knowledge and care. Greenwood accepts most kinds of insurance, and staff are there to answer your questions. Open Monday through Friday from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., the clinic serves the greater Danbury area and is a convenient drive from Reading. Appointments are available within 24 hours. Just call 203-917-4792 or visit greenwoodphysicaltherapy.com for more information.
You're watching the HAN Network, and you're not alone. More than 1.5 million viewers have watched our live sports, news, and entertainment broadcasting since the network launched in August 2015. Advertise on the network that reaches Fairfield County, Connecticut's most engaged audience. Contact Advertising Director Jessica Murren at 203-273-7312 or email jessica@han.network.
We are back on this Thursday, September 8th edition of Your Coffee Break on the HAN Network. And we're going to throw it over to Donald Lang now to take a look back on this day in history. Now, each day, Don, we've been trying to guess what you're going to include in the history report. And we're a little upset at you today because we got a preview of it. And it's something that a few of us guessed yesterday, but that you ended up including today. You found a way around. But I'll let you take it over, all right? Please.
Well, did you get the birth of an entertainment franchise today? That also happened. But first, we go to 1664, Dutch Governor Peter Stuyvesant surrenders New Amsterdam, the capital of New Netherlands, to an English naval squadron under Colonel Richard Nichols. Now, this is odd because the two countries were actually at peace at the time. Following its capture, the name was changed to New York in honor of the Duke of York, who organized the mission. In case you're wondering, the names for places like the Bowery, Brooklyn, the Bronx, Coney Island, Harlem, and Yonkers all have Dutch roots. To 1892, the Pledge of Allegiance, published in the Youth's Companion magazine by Francis Bellamy. Now, the wording was, "I pledge allegiance to my flag and the republic for which it stands, one nation indivisible, with liberty and justice for all." The pledge's wording has been changed three times since then, most recently 1954. By the way, those kids reciting the pledge there are making the Bellamy salute after Francis Bellamy, the pledge's author. That fell out of favor right around World War II for obvious reasons. To 1921 we go. 16-year-old Margaret Gorman, who had earlier been crowned Miss Washington, D.C., wins the Atlantic City Pageant's Golden Mermaid Trophy. Pageant officials expected her to defend her title the following year, but someone else won the 1922 Miss Washington, D.C. pageant, so Atlantic City officials invited her back as an honored guest with the retroactive title Miss America. She remains the only woman to receive her crown at the end of her year as Miss America. Finally, now we go to 1966, 50 years ago today, when we first saw this.
Captain's log, stardate 1513.1. Our position, orbiting planet M113. On board the Enterprise, Mr. Spock, temporarily in command. On the planet, the ruins of an ancient and long-dead civilization. Ship Surgeon McCoy and myself are now beaming down to the planet's surface. Our mission? Routine medical examination of archaeologist Robert Crater and his wife Nancy. Routine, but for the fact that Nancy Crater is that one woman in Dr. McCoy's past.
Yes, of course. NBC TV airs the first episode of Star Trek titled The Man Trap. The show was canceled in 1969, but it borrowed heavily from Western novels that creator Gene Roddenberry read as a child. If you watch the clip there, you saw the trend of Kirk, Bones, and someone else beaming down to the unknown planet. Star Trek has since spawned four spin-off series, with a fifth coming next year, and 13 feature films. That's your look back in history for today, September 8th, and I'm Donald Lang.
Don, I almost included the first Miss America in my guesses today.
Almost.
Now, of course, welcome...
So you almost took the lead.
We welcome you to play along. You only get bragging rights. There's no prizes involved, but, you know, you can always tweet us or Facebook message us if you think you know what will be in Don's history on this day.
I said you gotta watch film. There are some definite trends. Josh Bishop was pretty good at figuring them out.
But no history tomorrow because we're going to be in Ridgefield. So we'll miss you, but we'll see you again on Monday. All right, thanks so much, Don. In other news today, in Darien, a car stolen from a Lynn Court home was recovered in Stamford on August 30th. It had last been seen during the evening of August 26th and was reported stolen the next day. The car had been unlocked with the key hidden inside. Two McDonald's gift cards that had been inside of the car, valued at $100 and $50, were found on a neighbor's lawn nearby. Police found the car near Highview Avenue in Stamford August 30th with heavy front-end damage. Police said the driver had fled after crashing the car. When police contacted the owner regarding the car, the owner went on to report that there were two other cars that had been burglarized during that same evening. They were able to recover a pair of golf shoes and insurance cards from a neighbor's lawn, but nothing else was reported missing. But let's throw it back over to Frank Granito, who got two right in today's history report.
I did get two, and Josh Fisher, who was the leader in the clubhouse, went 0 for 4 today. So,
are you serious?
Absolutely.
I didn't know that. Oh, so, man.
But also, congratulations to Josh. I won't get to see him before Saturday. We want to wish him the best of luck this weekend.
That's some wedding luck that he had. It'll fade.
Taking a look at a couple local stories now, the Bridgeport Bluefish split a doubleheader yesterday with the Long Island Ducks, but the toughest loss for the Fish this weekend this week might have come in missing out on the signing of Tim Tebow. It was announced earlier today that Tim Tebow has agreed to a minor league contract with the New York Mets. So that is something to keep an eye on. We'll see if we can see Tim up in Queens anytime before the postseason. Former Fairfield Prep standout and New York Rangers captain Chris Drury was named an assistant general manager for the organization last week. Drury has been working as the head talent development and head pro scout for the Rangers. He accepts this promotion heading into the next season. The NFL season kicks off tonight as they get set to play games, but don't forget that the FCAC football season kicks off tomorrow night. All 17 teams will be in action, and the HAN Network will be live with FCAC tailgate at 5:10 and pregame of the Trumbull and Ridgefield game from Tiger Hollow tomorrow. And then on Saturday, we have a doubleheader as we head back to Stanford for Danbury and Stanford. Should be a lot of fun, Kate. Looking forward to having coffee break there tomorrow. We'll have you for the pregame show, yes. So yeah. Going to be a fun year.
Yeah, coffee break's going to be a blast tomorrow. We have some special guests from the Ridgefield Police Department, including their canine, so it'll be a lot of fun. Thanks so much, Frank. In other news today, Meriden police say that the director of the Meriden Humane Society has been arrested for allegedly forging the rabies vaccination certificate of an animal that was adopted by a member of the public. Police say they've been investigating the matter since April 2015 when they started getting reports of misconduct. On Wednesday, Marlena DiBianco turned herself in on a charge of forgery. She is free on a promise to appear in court on September 20th. And Stratford residents sent nearly 90 comments to the Federal Environmental Protection Agency to offer their thoughts on a proposed plan to clean up Raymark waste all over town. Residents had 2 months to give comments to the EPA on its proposed Raymark waste remediation plan. Between 80 and 85 comments were sent to the EPA via email or regular mail before the August 29th deadline, according to Marilyn St. Flour, an EPA spokesman. St. Flour indicated that the proposed plan, which will cover 4 operable units in town, had support and criticism, though she did not have an exact breakdown of the comments for and against the plan. She said the comments were diverse and have been overall balanced so far. She said the EPA team is still working with the comments, but more details about what they contained will be made available later. And in other news, Los Cabos, a Mexican restaurant in downtown Milford, is doing well enough that the owners are relocating to larger quarters just up River Street. The Milford Planning and Zoning Board at its September 6th meeting unanimously approved a site plan review allowing Jessica Trujillo and Daniel Wilhelm to open a restaurant at 911 River Street. Ultima LLC owns that property. The restaurant is moving into space formerly occupied by Villa Gourmet, which closed on August 25th, 2015. Trujillo told the board that the 1,600 square foot restaurant would have 49 seats. This is considerably larger than the 320 square foot current location, which you just saw a photo of. More on that story at MilfordMirror.com. And finally, it's not just stranded motorists who receive roadside assistance in Connecticut. Check out these photos from the Connecticut State Police. Troopers, Connecticut Department of Transportation Service Patrol, and Connecticut State Environmental Conservation Police flocked to the area of I-91 North near Exit 21 yesterday to provide some assistance to a hawk that was strolling along the shoulder. Luckily, things didn't take a turn for the worse, and officials say they were able to take the hawk under their wing and protect it from the cars flying by. They say no foul play is suspected in this case. DEP will be providing further assistance. Again, the State Police Facebook page wins today. They made several good jokes there. Good job, guys. We always enjoy reading it. But we are going to step out for a break, and when we come back, our editorial director, John Kovach, joins me, and we take a look at the front pages of our HAN Network papers this week after this.
Warm weather, light breezes, boats are in the water. There's no better place to celebrate summer than the Dock Shop. Whether in Darien at 51 Tokenique Road or Westport at 609 Riverside Avenue, the Dock Shop is where you'll find everything you need to kick off summer. From the latest summer apparel to the newest fishing tackle, the Dock Shop will help you get the most out of your next beach day or harbor cruise. At the Dock Shop, you'll find a wonderful selection of items made in the USA and right here in New England, all with a distinct nautical flair. Boater, beach bum, fisherman, or simply love the coastal lifestyle, this is a unique place to shop. DockShop.com.
A Better View Window Cleaning Plus has been cleaning glass all over Connecticut for over 20 years. They also specialize in cleaning chandeliers, mirrors, skylights, tiles, and will power wash anything that needs cleaning. They hold an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau and are fully insured and bonded. When you deal with a Better View, you're dealing with the best, not the rest. Call today for a free estimate, 203-284-8836, or visit them online at betterviewcleaning.com.
I'm John Kovach. I'm a newspaper editor. I'm a high school football coach. I'm a television presenter, and I want you to love fishing as much as I do. Tune in to Yankee Fisherman, Thursdays at 1 on the HAN Network. It's like going to the tackle shop without leaving your office.
I'm Frank Granito.
And I'm Donald Ng for the HAN Network.
Tune in to Nutmeg Sports Monday through Wednesday, where we bring you all the top stories for Connecticut sports.
From players and coaches' interviews to expert opinions with local sports editors, no one gets you closer to Connecticut's games than Nutmeg Sports.
Nutmeg Sports, Monday through Wednesday at 2 p.m. on the HAN Network.
We are back on this Thursday edition of Your Coffee Break. Happy to be back in studio this Thursday. John Kovach joins me to preview the front pages of our HAN papers this week. John, what do we have up first?
Back to school. And
yes.
Back to school is everywhere. We're starting in New Canaan. Some great shots there, the kids returning to school. But also big news, because Steve Kleppen has been the town planner in New Canaan since I was down there, and that was years and years ago. And he is planning to resign to take a job as director of planning and zoning for the city of Norwalk, that being reported by the New Canaan Advertiser. Plus news on a Monday night fire on Main Street in New Canaan, and the second in a series on campus safety. What do you have?
All right, well, I'm taking a look at the front page of the Milford Mirror. Of course, some school photos. Milford's last of three Catholic schools is here to stay. St. Mary's School, they say. I know there's been some closings recently in many towns. So a story on that by Jill Dion. Also, West Nile reported in Milford, actually a person infected with West Nile. It's the first in the state. Something we've talked about previously, but Chris Murphy's walk through Milford during his walk across the state there. And a fundraiser plan for a Milford teen that they discovered. She's a Division I athlete, and she has an inoperable brain tumor, and there's been a lot of community support around her.
A softball player, a member of the Stratford Breakettes, and there has been a tremendous groundswell of support for Danny. In Easton, we have a profile of Tara O'Connell, and Tara is following her dream of competing in triathlons, and a very cool shot there from one of the races that she completed. $150,000 anonymously donated to the new playground at Helen Keller Middle School. Continuing discussions about where they're going to park school buses, and that is being batted back and forth by Easton and Reading. And an Easton man winning an invention show. Looking forward to reading that. Those people just fascinate me, who can take anything right. And make it into anything.
Very cool. All right, well, taking a look at the Ridgefield Press, a nice photo of the Prospector Theater 5K fun run that they held over the weekend. Had a lot of participants there, 200 in total. And town listing 26 properties for tax auction. Interesting there. You can get more information. And, of course, the story we've been following, but urination on a Wilton field sparking a Ridgefield-Wilton fight between some students there. One football player was brought to the hospital by his parents last week. And RMAC receiving a youthful boost. Founding member is the new program director of that program.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah.
Very cool. Story that you brought us on Coffee Break. At the lead spot of the Shelton Herald, that the arrest and the hit and run right before Christmas that killed a cyclist on Bridgeport Avenue. Also a story about the increasing availability of Narcan to reverse opioid overdoses, and a lemonade stand that raised more than $6,000 to fight pediatric cancer.
Oh, that's great. All right, well, I'm taking a look at the front page of the Monroe Courier. Big event in Monroe this weekend. I've heard it's amazing. I'm hoping to finally check it out this year. But the annual Apple Festival will be in Monroe. St. Peter's Episcopal Church is hosting that. I've heard it's a lot of fun. Arts and Culture Council in its early stages in Monroe, a newly formed council there. And a bridge on Route 34 slated for replacement in 2018, and the DOT is seeking public comment on that already.
This story, I think, might date back to you being in Trumbull, and that the cell tower near the police station that's finally going to start working. That is right by the police department. It's a communications monopole, and we shall see, because there are too many dead spots in Fairfield County.
There are, especially in Trumbull Center, which is just a quick drive from there. So interesting story there.
Also, the 9/11 tribute, the CT United ride, that's coming up this weekend. Always a huge event. And the Trumbull Fall Festival also this weekend.
A lot of good stuff. All right, well, I'm taking a look at the front page of the Darien Times. Some great back-to-school photos, some happy faces. Maybe some not so happy that they're back-to-school.
For the most part, yeah.
And planning and zoning debate over building height rules. This coming kind of in response to Baywater Properties proposal for the downtown area there. And schools across the district to see some upgrades. And commission approves mandatory referral for the field lights at Darien High School.
In Weston, Brian Hafley gets great photos, and this is one because he really captures the emotion of the moment. This in Weston again, and it is a first grade teacher, Erin Merrifield, and she's greeting first graders. Just the joy that's captured in that photo is just tremendous. He does an awesome job with that. The 9/11 memorial will be Sunday in Weston. Story that you brought us just a little bit ago, the medical leave being taken by Weston First Selectman Nina Daniel, and now a second meeting going on regarding that, and also possibly regarding the fact that one town employee has left and two have announced that they're leaving. So that could also be part of the meeting being held in Weston tonight. And Fred Hellerman, in his own words, he was the last surviving member of the folk group The Weavers, which also featured Pete Seeger, Lee Hayes, and Ronnie Gilbert. Fred Hellerman died last week at the age of 89.
All right, well, taking a look at the front page of the Reading Pilot, of course, some back to school. Meadow celebrated at Land Trust Wine Talk August 27th. And in Easton, the school chief mulling over the pros and cons of a bus depot.
That Meadow one, there's very cute pictures of llamas.
Oh, yeah.
At that celebration.
Oh,
I know we
fun.
Have some llama fans out there.
We have some llama fans out there, yes.
So we won't say who. We won't say who. Schools open again in Wilton, and that leading the bulletin there, as well as a look back at the 15th anniversary of the terrorist attacks of September 11th. And then Wilton author has written a story, True Tales from the Psych Ward.
Wow.
That could be very interesting.
Sounds
and
interesting.
Harrowing and possibly uplifting, and I'm really not sure what direction that could go
right.
in.
Right. All right, well, taking a look at the front page of the Stratford Star, of course, back to school, smiles and sprinkles mark the start of the school year. Melvin Mason taking some photos and writing up a story. Also some news this week, a fifth district candidate for town council pulling out of a special council race, James
that
Duffy.
That happens so much in Stratford.
Yes, it seems to. And as well as coverage of U.S. Senator Chris Murphy walking to Stratford. And of course, football season in Stratford opening Friday, so lots of fun there.
Prominent on the cover of the Arts and Leisure section, the gambler himself, Kenny Rogers, who is going to be the featured performer at the opening gala for the Ridgefield Playhouse, and that is on Saturday, September 17th.
All right, very cool. And we should say HAN Arts and Leisure is not on today. It's actually moving to a new time. It's going to be on Mondays at 12:30. So we're really excited about that. People have time to plan out their weekend around some of the events that we highlight on that show.
Cool.
So, but we do have Yankee Fisherman coming up today.
Oh, it's going to be a fun one.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed this one. In June, we had Chris Fisher, who is the founder of O-Search. They're known for the shark tracker applications that people have on their smartphones. The show Sharkmen and Shark Wranglers, which they don't do anymore, but they're still out there tagging sharks releasing them and helping with scientific research. Well, we got to spend a day out there with them off Montauk on the boat. Got a ton of film, a number of segments, and today's features some students from a local high school who had the opportunity to spend a week out there with the scientists and anglers learning about tagging sharks. We also took a trip up to the Farmington, which was closed a couple weeks ago due to, not all of it, parts of it were closed, let's be clear about that, because of high temperatures and low water levels. There are still places to fish. We talk about that, and you'll watch two guys stalk a fish for the better part of an hour. That's at 1 o'clock.
All right. So that's coming up at 1 o'clock. John, thank you so much. We're going to wrap things up here. Tomorrow, your coffee break will be live at Tiger Hollow in Ridgefield, so be sure to check it out. We'll see you then.